Judit Kormos. She is a professor of applied linguistics at Lancaster University in the United Kingdom. She is renowned for her work on motivation in second language learning and self-regulation in second language writing. Her current interest is in dyslexia as a second language learning. So hi, Judit, and welcome so much. Thank you so much for coming on the show today.
Thank you for inviting me to be on the show in the first place, and a very warm welcome to the listeners. And it's such a pleasure to talk to you about dyslexia and learning of additional languages.
Great, great. Judith, we might get started, so, because I've got a huge amount of questions. I don't think I'm going to have time to cover them all. So I suppose, first of all, where did your interest in dyslexia come from?
Well, it came 20 years ago when I was teaching psycholinguistics at a university in Hungary. And one of my master's students said, you know, if you teach psycholinguistics, you must know something about dyslexia. And I had to admit, I knew nothing about dyslexia at that time. And then I said, well, but if you want to write your dissertation on this topic, then let's go out and research it together. So I learned with my students, and then the interest grew, and there were lots of other people around me who were interested in this topic, and we started to investigate this together about 15 years ago with a team of people in Hungary.
Great, great. Tell me, what links have you found between second language acquisition and learning disabilities?
So in general, students with specific learning difficulties or dyslexia tend to have difficulties learning an additional language. And this is because the skills that underlie first language literacy and learning another language, they are very strongly interrelated.
Okay.
And first language skills are foundations for learning an additional language. So in general, students with specific learning difficulties do find learning additional languages difficult. They usually achieve somewhat below students who don't have learning difficulties, but that doesn't mean that every student who has a learning difficulty will necessarily have challenges learning an additional language.
Okay.
There are actually very good language learners among students with specific learning difficulties, and there are also students who are perhaps unsuccessful learning another language, but they don't necessarily have a specific learning difference.
Absolutely, absolutely. I suppose as an aside, Judith, I know that here in Ireland, people with autism, it's recommended that people with autism would learn German perhaps over French as a second language. Would you find that would be the case, that you stick with the language that has the most similar rules or the most similar sounds phonetically speaking or whatever?
Well, it is a difficult question because, even you know, when you learn a language, of course, sounds and spelling is just one aspect of learning a language. There are many other aspects of a language that can pose difficulty, and languages differ in many
yeah.
other areas, not just spelling and pronunciation. So, for example, German has a lot of articles. And you have to remember the gender of the nouns.
Yeah.
So that, again, might be a challenge for a dyslexic student. So although the spelling and pronunciation may not be so challenging, remembering all the information about gender can be. So I usually try to avoid giving advice what language
okay.
Students should learn, because I think it should, you know, language learning stem from some kind of intrinsic interest.
Okay.
And if in an ideal world, I would give the choice to the student.
Yeah, absolutely.
What language to learn, and if they are motivated to learn that language, they will overcome the specific difficulties of the given language.
And that's absolutely right. That is absolutely always coming back to the person every single time is the most important thing, really.
Going back to autism and languages, perhaps, I mean, one reason why German might be recommended is that German is a fairly regular language.
Okay.
With fewer exceptions than, for example, English as a second language. So perhaps that's why, and students with autism prefer regularities.
Okay.
So that's one of the reasons why, for example, German might be a good choice, because it's a very logical language.
Perfect, perfect. Thank you. Judith, what features differentiate the acquisition of a second language in dyslexic and non-dyslexic learners?
Well, what we have found in our studies is that students do have difficulties learning to read in another language. They have difficulties remembering words. They need a lot more repetition for a word to stick in their mind. They have, of course, challenges when it comes to spelling and writing. Usually, oral skills of dyslexic students can be very good. They can understand spoken text relatively well. And they can usually also speak the language up to a relatively high standard. What might happen, though, is when information is communicated through listening, they might forget the information. So if a lot of information is said, then they may not. And with speaking, sometimes students with specific learning difficulties have challenges structuring their thoughts, organizing their ideas.
Okay.
And when they have to produce a longer text, either in writing or speaking, it might not be as coherent as one might expect.
Okay. Can I ask you, Judith, again as an aside, actually, is that I know I've been reading lately that Uta Frith speaks about dyslexia being a language-based challenge rather than a visual-based challenge, as so many people perceive dyslexia to be. I wonder, is there a reason why people perceive dyslexia to be a visual difficulty rather than a language-based difficulty?
Well, I think it originates perhaps about the common misconception that reading is a visual process.
And whereas
we know from psychological research that actually very little of reading is visual.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you do look at the letters and you recognize their shapes, but from that point on, there are at least five or six other language-based processes that play a role in how we read. So actually visual processing plays a relatively small role, and I think it's a historic misconception about dyslexia that it's a visual problem. It is language-based.
Okay.
And it's related to phonological processing, to how people deal with sounds.
Okay, and based on that then, Judith, I know here again in Ireland, I'm focusing specifically on Ireland because this is where I have my experience base, we'd say. I know here in Ireland, oftentimes children are just sent home with, we'd say, a toe-by-toe programme where they learn how one word looks, and then you build and you change one letter and they learn how that one looks, and so on and so forth, trying to build up a base of vocabulary. Is there a different approach that teachers or educators could be taking to work on that phonological challenge rather than considering it to be just a visual problem?
Well, I mean, the question is whether, you know, you're asking it for first language learning or second language learning. For first language literacy development, working with sound, differentiating which sound is longer, which sound is shorter, sounds like p-b, which differ just in voiceless distinction. So working on that as a basic phonological skill is very important in the pre-reading or early reading skills.
Okay.
Blending sounds, deleting sounds, playing with sounds within words is something that is very beneficial in early stages of learning to read.
Okay.
And then kind of reinforcing the correspondence between letters and sounds, and then also regularities of how different sounds are spelled, and teaching these regularities explicitly is very, very useful for children who have specific learning difficulties. But they are useful for everyone. My son is an ESOL learner. He spoke no English when he came to the UK, and he was given support in ESOL, but also he was sent to the dyslexia reading class as a five-year-old, and his reading skills just took off wonderfully. So it's useful for everybody, not just students with dyslexia.
Great. And would you follow the same kind of protocol for the second language acquisition?
Yes, I would, especially if they are young learners. Obviously, with adults, you don't go back too much into the phonological system. But with young learners, yes, definitely.
Okay.
Especially if the phonological system of the other language is very, very different from your first language.
Okay, perfect. Would it be appropriate for dyslexia interventions to be delivered through the child's first language, so are their second language, their L1 or their L2? Do you find, Judith, that would it be most appropriate to use their first language as a means to teach their second language? Does that make sense?
Yes, it does. I mean, we know now that using the children's first language in learning an additional language is a huge resource. And there have been studies in the U.S. With Spanish as first language populations, with at-risk students, and they delivered the phonological training in the student's first language in Spanish, and then they looked at later their attainment in English, because that's the language in which they were schooled, and it was very helpful. The students improved a lot.
Great.
But they also did phonological interventions in the student's second language.
Okay.
So English in this case, with students living in the target country, and the second language intervention was almost as useful as the first language one. But ideally, in the early stages, the strengthening the home language is very helpful. So that again goes against the common misconception.
Yeah.
And home languages play a very important role in learning an additional language, or even helping students to learn a third language as such.
Okay, great. Tell me, Judith, how should service providers adapt the strategies they recommend to dyslexic clients to accommodate bilingualism?
Well, that's not a very easy question, but
yeah.
But obviously, if translations are available or interpreters are available, that's very helpful, because obviously information can be much better understood if it's communicated in someone's stronger language.
Okay.
Of course, what we have found, for example, if information is presented through multiple channels, so not just in written form,
yeah,
but spoken form. Nowadays, it's so easy to record speech, and for example, health text could be put on the website with a sound file.
Okay.
So that someone can read and listen at the same time. And then obviously thinking about how complex that text is in terms of language, and simplifying it so that the meaning stays the same, but it's conveyed in a more comprehensible format that, again, is helpful for low literacy populations as well.
Okay.
Again, read aloud might, again, be helpful for people who have low literacy in their first language, not just necessarily because of dyslexia.
Okay.
So that these would be my suggestions as a linguist for service providers.
Great, and I suppose those suggestions, Judith, would feed right across individuals, regardless of challenges that they may face, be it dyslexia or autism or dyspraxia or whatever that specific learning challenge would be.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, I would pay attention to a number of things, like with individuals with autism, then avoiding using figurative language,
yeah,
or metaphors. And again, that's very useful for second language speakers as well,
yeah,
because they may not understand those metaphors, or they may misunderstand them, or they may misunderstand figurative language.
Okay.
So if you were thinking about a wider range of learning difficulties, then you need to consider also the specifics of
that specific
learning difficulty and add that. And I think then you can arrive perhaps an inclusive solution which benefits everyone.
Perfect. Judith, what about dyslexic learners picking up a second language or an L2 at a later stage, be the end of primary school or the start of secondary school, is oftentimes when you see a French, German, Spanish, whatever, being introduced into the curriculum. How do we best support our dyslexic students at that point?
Well, I think we can support them in a number of ways. There are methods that can ensure that language teaching is inclusive and that the specific needs of students are attended to, and there are classroom accommodations to assist the students, for example, giving outlines of lessons, notes, glossaries, word lists, key points for the students, giving them reading guides to help them understand text, breaking down instructions into smaller steps, giving more explanation, giving them more time, more practice opportunities when a task is shown, then demonstrating how the task should be done, suggesting additional practice activities online. Nowadays there's a repertoire of different online tools to practice languages, and not just English but French, Spanish, etc. Allowing more time for assessment, giving students a break when they complete the assessment, and also encouraging self-regulation, making sure that students know when they have to hand in tasks, using diaries, lots of encouragement, positive feedback. We talked about phonological awareness raising, and I think that can be a part of teaching another additional language. Explicit instruction on a number of things. Students with dyslexia find it difficult to figure out some of the regularities of language, so we might have to explain certain things to them, how they work, that other students might figure out themselves.
Okay.
Using multisensory teaching methods.
Great.
Presenting information through multiple channels, asking students to act out things, imagine things, helping them with learning strategies to remember information. So
there's a multitude.
I could continue
absolutely
the list, for a long time.
Absolutely, and they all make actually great sense. You're talking about experiential learning with people getting up and modelling it or acting it out. You're talking about using visuals or using auditory channels, or they all make so much sense. And it definitely, it would be great for any educators listening in today to take those comments and those strategies on board, because they can, I suppose, they can be the difference between a child's acquisition of a second language and not.
Yes, absolutely. And then I can just add that students with dyslexia or specific learning difficulties, they can become very, very successful language learners. They just need a bit more support and perhaps a bit more time also. So a bit slower paced instruction. More opportunities for revision and recycling.
Perfect. And now I do have a question. I'm not sure, have you answered it, but I might ask it anyway. I know that here in Ireland, often children with dyslexia are given an exemption from learning a second language, as it's feared that the effort taken to acquire such a skill might affect their other academic work. I suppose, is this the right course of action, do you feel, or should we be focusing more on adapting supports to encourage individuals' language acquisition despite their difficulties? I know in my house I have two children with dyslexia, one of whom has a condition that you're probably aware of. It's Ireland syndrome, where it's where he has tinted lenses to use to be able to read, and so on and so forth. And both of my sons are exempt from Irish initially, and now the secondary school aged child is also exempt from French and German, those two languages that are offered in the school. So it means that they don't, I suppose, that is the way in which we are advised as parents to work with second language acquisition in Ireland. What's your feeling on that?
Well, it's difficult to give advice. Of course, as a second language acquisition researcher, my basic advice is give everyone the opportunity to learn an additional language.
Yeah.
Because learning an additional language can bring, even if you don't learn it to a very high standard, there are a lot of advantages. You understand how your own language works better, for example. You gain intercultural understanding. You learn perspective taking, and you enrich yourself as a person. A very recent study has found, for example, that English Welsh bilinguals who were dyslexic had better phonological awareness, than monolinguals who just spoke English.
Okay.
So there are certain advantages of bilingualism, yeah, for dyslexic students as well. Now, of course, each case is individual.
Yeah.
So I wouldn't give blanket advice, because obviously if a student has such a big difficulty that too much of their effort and energy would be taken up by learning an additional language, and if it would lead to increased anxiety, then of course there is no other way than to exempt the child. But I would ask parents to consider carefully what their child might be missing.
Yeah.
And also think about especially with autistic children, the students are missing out in terms of social interaction.
Yeah.
So if you let's say with Irish, whether they will miss out any of the activities that are related to the use of Irish in a specific community.
Yeah.
Or if you go and visit relatives who live in France and they only speak French, do they miss out on those opportunities?
Yes.
And also I have seen with, for example, autistic children that learning an additional language can help them with their social skills as well. And they somehow putting on a persona of another speaker can enhance their communication skills.
That's great, actually. Good. That's a great point. I suppose for me, Judith, I think as a parent, I'm looking at the way in which Irish, for example, is delivered in the education system, and it didn't best suit my children right now. But I do wonder, had it been offered without the pressure of exams or without the pressure of that kind of rote learning, insistence on rote learning and knowing all of the rules and so on and so forth, if there had been a gentler way in which it's taught, I wonder, would that make it more attainable for people with autism and with dyslexia and other challenges?
Absolutely. And my home country, Hungary, there are two ways of exempting students. One is exempting the students from attending classes overall, and the other one is exemption from assessment.
Yeah.
So that would be, again, from a legislative point of view, that would be another opportunity to allow the students to experience the language, but again, without the pressure. And of course, yes, rote learning is not very helpful for dyslexic students overall.
Exactly.
So we need to think about more inclusive methods of language teaching, and then language learning is accessible for everyone.
Perfect. Tell me, Judith, is the verbal acquisition of an L2 or a second language influenced by a diagnosis of dyslexia?
I'm not sure I understand this question well. What do you mean by verbal acquisition?
I suppose for somebody to be able to learn how to speak a second language, to understand and to be able to converse in a second language, does dyslexia impact on one's learning of a language in general, I suppose, so that they can become fluent and speak that second language?
Well, I think what we see in immersion contexts, right?
Yeah.
Not necessarily classroom learning. Now, dyslexic students can become very successful learners in those contexts. They can learn how to speak. They can learn how to understand the language. Obviously, then, because they are not taught formally, their writing and reading skills will lag behind. But in that case, everybody's writing and reading skills lag behind.
Okay.
Because you are not exposed to print or you're not expected to write in that language. Dyslexic students might be a little bit slower in that context as well, because they might find learning words difficult. But it can be a very helpful context for them to learn. So we have seen that dyslexic students can become quite successful in immersion contexts.
Okay.
So I guess I don't know if
no,
they
I
have
suppose
immersion schools in Ireland, but in other nurse nowadays in the UK, some nurseries have started, or primary schools have started to teach subjects through another language.
Good.
And,
good.
And this can be helpful for dyslexic students.
I suppose here in Ireland, up until more recent times, we were very much a singular culture society. I know that society is changing very, very rapidly now, and we are becoming a much more diverse society. I know that I spoke to people recently, one person from Croatia, actually, who is studying to be a special needs assistant. So I know that... things are changing in Ireland, and it would be great to see people delivering lesson plans even at the preschool stage in different languages, because it is encompassing of other cultures within Irish society. It's just I don't reckon that we're maybe there yet. Do you know that we seem to be a little bit behind, because it's only in the last few years that our society has started to become more diverse. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Do you know,
and
so
I think as I said, the student's home language is a huge resource.
Exactly.
Of course, you won't be able to cater for all languages in a classroom, but drawing on that resource one way or another is very helpful for the students, bringing in their own language skills and you know, they can be specialists in their own language.
Yeah.
Contrast that with the language spoken in the classroom, even if the teacher doesn't speak that language.
Yeah.
That can be very, very helpful.
Great. Tell me, Judith, in your research, have you come across any links between autism and the acquisition of a second language?
I haven't done any specific research on autism and second language acquisition. However, I had a master's student a couple of years ago who investigated or conducted a case study of five autistic children in Hong Kong who were learning English as an additional language, but they were also learning Mandarin, which is the written form or the standard form of Chinese that they use for literacy, whereas the students, because they were from Hong Kong, their first language was Cantonese.
Okay.
And what this study found, that these students were all on the high-functioning spectrum of autism, they were much more successful in English as their third language than they were in Mandarin, which was the official language of literacy.
Okay.
And I have anecdotal evidence from the circle of friends with students who have high-functioning ASD, and they become very, very successful language learners.
Great. So I suppose it's important that any parents listening in today know that autism isn't necessarily something that will hold their child back from acquiring.
They might be better than average.
Great.
Because they have the patience to learn the words, they can be very diligent if something sparks their interest.
Yeah.
And they can take huge pride in speaking the language better than anybody else.
Absolutely.
So it has been found that many people on the high functioning autism spectrum are actually almost exceptional language learners.
Fabulous. Thank you for that. With regards to your eye tracking study, Judith, I know you completed an eye tracking study recently. Would you be able to explain a little bit about the results of the study for my listeners and the implications it could have on language intervention with individuals with learning disabilities in the future?
Well, thank you for asking about it. Well, this was a very interesting study because you can use an eye tracker to see what people are paying attention to while they read. And we conducted a study in which we gave students three texts to read.
Okay.
And each text had seven examples of a new grammatical construction, so something they didn't know. But it was embedded in a story, so people were reading the story. And in principle, the story wasn't really understandable if you didn't figure out what this grammatical construction meant.
Okay.
And we tracked their eyes while they were reading. And we were interested in whether they are paying attention to this new grammatical construction. And there were four conditions. One, just a regular text. The second, we highlighted the grammatical construction. And the third one, we told them there is a new grammatical construction in the text. As you read, try to pay attention to it. And in the fourth condition, after they read the first text, we explained the grammatical construction to them, and then they read the second and the third text. Now, what was very surprising in this study, that when we didn't tell the students to pay attention to the grammatical construction in the text, they didn't pay any attention to it, or very little.
Okay.
And there was basically very little learning through reading.
Okay.
Which shows that when you teach another language, it's really important to call students' attention to new linguistic structures.
Okay.
So just simply by reading a lot, I mean, of course, by reading a lot, you can still develop your language skills, but you need to pay close attention to new things that you don't know in that language. And what we found was that we also measured students' working memory capacity.
Okay.
Working memory is to do with how many pieces of information one can hold and manipulate in short-term memory.
Yes.
And students with learning difficulties are generally performing poorer on this task. They can manipulate just smaller number of information at a time.
Okay.
And what we found was that there was a very strong relationship between how much attention students paid to these new items, new language items, and working memory, and also between how much they learned in this experiment.
Okay.
So people with high working memory capacity paid more attention and learned more, and people with low working memory capacity didn't pay so much attention and didn't learn a lot. And
okay.
that has indirect implications for teaching students with learning difficulties, because it means that we need to give the students not only explicit teaching that you need to pay attention, you need to try to work out what the regularity is, but they need much more exposure and probably more practice for learning. So that was our conclusion.
Very interesting, very interesting.
Study.
Fab. No, very, very interesting. I suppose it's always good. It's really good. I know people talk about leaving somebody learn independently or whatever, but it's actually very good that someone is aware that they should call the attention of the learner to what they're meant to be learning as well, not always assuming that it will be learned implicitly, if you know what I mean.
Yes, exactly. Yes, yes, yes. Very often teachers think that what they want to teach actually coincides with the focus of the student's attention, and that doesn't seem to be the case.
Absolutely, absolutely. On that note, Judith, what kind of classroom-wide strategies could teachers implement into their environment and teaching style in general to make the material they cover more automatically accessible to children with learning disabilities?
Well, I think it's important how you present the information. So, how it's laid out on a page, for example, that for dyslexic students, the text shouldn't be too crowded, that you should clearly break it up into manageable chunks, that you should preferably also present it multimodally, read it out as well. When you break it up into parts, then maybe the comprehension questions can come after each part.
Yeah.
You can also differentiate in reading, that perhaps dyslexic students don't have to read the whole text, they can just read half of it, or you can select certain key bits of the text and ask students to read that. Highlighting the key pieces of information, preparing reading guides, what to pay attention to in the text can also be very, very useful.
Great, great. I suppose I know that in our house what we do is we tend to work on the very basics, what, when, where, why and how, highlighting what information is actually needed in the text, what is the important parts of the text and so on and so forth. Works well in our house just to kind of help my children learn how to pull the relevant information out of, do you know, like we'd say even in maths questions, the sum of means adding or the total of, if you know, teaching those specific rules, specific words explicitly so that the child is equipped with that knowledge as well.
Yes, exactly. And then maybe if you can even, you know, match it with a visual image.
Yeah.
Like the sum is, you know, when you put all the apples in one basket, so associate sum is with S, basket with an S, whatever works, you know, you can invent your own memory aids with the help of the child, and then deduction means taking away, so imagine taking out from the basket and so on, that is also very helpful if you can visualize, you know, the words, the instruction, the information in the text.
Perfect, perfect. No, I'm actually, believe it or not, Judith, I'm kind of starting to run out of time, so I'm going to have to cut down questions. I'm actually going to just ask you two more, if that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
I suppose one of them would be, there's a thing called Dyslexia for Teachers of English Foreign Language Project. Would you tell people a little bit about this and where they would gain more information on this for people that would be interested?
Well, that project is a compilation of teacher training materials for teaching English as an additional language, but a lot of the techniques are applicable to teaching other additional languages. So that's available on the www.distafel.eu website.
Perfect.
And it's a self-study course for teachers that you can download or do online and do a quiz. And
great.
We also run every year in April, we run a massive open online learning course called Dyslexia and Language Teaching. And that's moderated in the sense that during the 4 weeks we have mentors on the program. It's partly based on the success of the Distafel course, and it's free of charge.
Great.
And we cover topics like what dyslexia is, how it affects language learning, how can we teach reading, listening, writing, speaking to dyslexic students, and how we can enhance students' phonological awareness.
Great.
And there are lots of discussion tasks and a lot of, there is a lot of interaction on that course. And we have not just teachers of languages on that course, but also other subject teachers.
Okay.
And we have had, for example, teachers of Irish on the course in the past.
Okay.
As well. But also parents who are interested in dyslexia, and also sometimes dyslexic students and adults themselves to understand their own strengths and weaknesses better.
Sounds like a very accessible and very all-encompassing course, Judith. It's great. It's great. I might actually post on our Facebook page about like some information about it, should people want to find out more about it.
Yes, that would be great. Thank
great,
you.
Great. Listen, I suppose the final question I'm going to ask you today, Judith, because I know I have a lot of parents listening in today, parents of children with autism, dyspraxia, dyslexia, and other specific learning difficulties. What strategies can people implement at home to improve one of the above students' learning?
Well, I think at home the parents can help a lot with, for example, different memory games that you can play, creating memory cards. If it's about another language, then labeling things in the home with the word, you know, the bookshelf, putting a label on the bookshelf in another language. Computer games, finding the online programs that assist language teaching and showing it to the children.
Great.
We often think that the students are digital natives and they will know how to do it. I think they need a lot of guidance on how to use all this wide repertoire of apps and software that is out there that is very useful. And I think checking students' learning, helping them revise, encouraging them not to give up, and praise them for whatever achievement they make. I think these are key. And then overall, we know from educational research that the stronger the parents' involvement in the students' learning, the higher their attainment.
Great.
So
great.
If the children see that their parents do care, let's say about language learning, and they do believe that learning additional languages are important, and they try to create the opportunities for using that language, the students will be much more motivated to learn.
Great. Listen, Judith, thank you so, so much for coming on the air today. I wish I had more time to speak with you. The information that you've shared has been wonderful, and I've no doubt that my listeners will find it hugely beneficial. Judith, thank you so, so much for your time today, and I look forward to speaking with you again in the future.
Well, thank you for inviting me. It's been really a very interesting conversation.
Perfect. Thank you, Judith. Take care.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye-bye.
Bye.